I got the horse right here, the name is Paul Revere, and here's the guy that says if the weather's clear, can do, can do. This guy says the horse can do.
Back to my channel on Vegas Stories. These stories I put together for these videos encompass all my time here in the city of Las Vegas. 46 years and counting. Long time I've been here. Primarily, they all cover like race and sports book stories, betting stories, gambling stories. All my time here in the city of Las Vegas, because I work for two licensed Nevada horse race disseminators. Okay, I got to travel around the country quite a bit and visit a lot of the racetracks, so stories encompass racetracks as well. I also work for one of the disseminators on the newspaper called The Sports Form. It was a sports gaming tabloid. Like I said, it came out weekly. I was a columnist. I did college football handicapping, so I got stories in that. As I said, you know, I deviate. I'm all over the map with this shit. I tell stories all over the place. Not every story takes place in Vegas. Obviously, some take place outside the state as well. So that's the essence. Let's push it aside. Let's get down to my alcohol of the day. Normally covering the beer, but I have been covering a little bit of the alcohol too. Recent videos, primarily scotch. So I'm going to bring out another bottle of scotch. You're going to like this one because this is affordable. This is a nice, I'm going to show it to you. It's a nice blended scotch. It's called the Famous Grouse. Take a look at this thing. Scotland, 40% alcohol level. It's all buzz. No bloat here. You're going to drink this. You're going to enjoy it, okay? Go easy with it, okay? Great drink to put on the rocks. Put it on the rocks. This is incredible scotch. You're going to love it, okay? Want that little water? Go for it. You know, we want drinking neat. You're on top of the world. You know what happens with that stuff. You can't stop guzzling this shit. You know that, okay? It's scotch, 40%. This ain't beer. So enjoy it. Nice color, nice flavor, all that kind of crap. Eat a little bit, too. It'll help you, you know, so... You know, you won't get drunk as quick. All right, let's push the alcohol aside. Let's get into my story of the day. So I'm going to take you back here. I'm going to go all the way back about 30 years. Now, this is a story that doesn't relate to race and sports. I'm going to talk about a story about being a dad. Okay, so I'm going to give you a little bit of background here. So I got involved with this wonderful lady that I'm married to for 34 years. It's phenomenal. When I first met her a long, long time ago, okay, she had a daughter. I mean, she had a 10-year-old daughter, going to be about 11 at the time. You know, so I got thrust into fatherhood at a relatively, you know, young age, and obviously the girl had been, you know, 10 years. I mean, you're not part of the developmental stage when you have a 10-year-old daughter. So obviously, you're picking up, you know, a girl at that particular time, and you're going to try to nurture her. Now, understand a little bit about me, okay? I'm the oldest of five boys in my family, okay? And biologically, after I had this daughter, I had two other boys, okay? Then I adopted two other boys after that. So the point is, I got a lot of males in my life. Not really good with the females. In fact, the only females I ever knew in my life, I married all of them. There were three of them. I knew them real well, married every one of them. So the point is, I'm not really good with the women, but I am Italian. I'm full Italian, so that means... Doesn't matter, it's a stepdaughter. I'm going to take care of this child like it's my own. I mean, and not only my own, but in other words, you know, you're not going to touch anything with this particular woman, okay? Because I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to be right on top of anybody who's going to get in her face type of shit, you know? So the point is that, you know, one day I came home after a hot day at work, I show up at the house, you know? Now, understand, the girl now at the time, yeah, she was about 16 years old, you know, we've been around my life, as I said, for about 5-6 years. You know, great relationship with her, all this kind of crap. I come home, hot day at work. I finally come back in the house. You know, my wife looks at me. She says, I just want to let you know that, you know, your daughter's boyfriend's in the parlor. And I said, really? So understand, you know, in my house, when I grew up as a kid, you understand what I'm talking about. Living room is where you watch the TV. Parlor, that's kind of where the good furniture is. You know, you kind of meet special type of shit over there. You're talking about special meetings. You don't use the parlor furniture. Parlor furniture is the best furniture in the house. Nobody goes near the parlor furniture. You know, if they do, you got to like dust the freaking tables. You got to vacuum the rugs. You got to clean them. I mean, the thing is, it's a special room. So I got to go meet. I got to walk in the other room. I got to introduce myself to this so-called boyfriend at the time, you know, because I think he was like 18. You know, my daughter was like 16 at the time. So I walk in. So as I'm walking in, picture this. This sets up the whole conversation here. Now, understand, full Italian. I'm going to go meet the boy that's dating my daughter, okay? So I understand where I'm going with this. I walk in a room. What do you think I see? Okay. This boy's laying on my expensive couch. He's got his combat boots up on the side of the of the couch, okay? And he's laying in my daughter's lap. So right off the bat, I'm thinking, not good here, not good. This isn't a great presentation type of shit. So I walk over to the kid. You know, I mean, he did jump up kind of quick. I'm not going to say he kind of got up lazily, but he did get up a little quick. And then you know what he looked? He looked at me, he goes, hey, dude. Wow. Imagine that, an 18-year-old dating my daughter. He's in my house. He's got his shoes on my expensive furniture. He stands up and he introduces himself and calls me dude. Well, that kind of sets the tenor right there. I'm telling you right now, that didn't sit real good with me. I'm having a little problem with it to start off with because he was freaking feet were on my couch. So a little bit of an issue with this kid. So needless to say, yeah, of course I shook his hand, but I gave him kind of like, I gave him the eyes. I gave him the evil eyes. I mean, I don't know if I put the curse on him, but I was hitting him with this shit. So I told you about that movie with Il Malocchio. I was trying really hard to pass something. I said, hey, yeah, yeah, you look real good. Yeah, yeah, sure you do. Hope you fall down the stairs, you little bitch. So the thing is that I mean, I had a little conversation with him. Yeah, it didn't go too good because, you know, one thing you never want to do with an Italian father, okay, is any type of disrespect. If you disrespect, I mean, it doesn't even have to be Italian, but Italian especially, because I can only speak for my nationality, but I know there's other people involved. You disrespect the father, you're off on the wrong foot. In fact, it's like you have no feet. I mean, the point is this was a bad situation for this kid. Did he pay the price? You bet your fucking ass he did. I made his life miserable after that. Why? Because he disrespected the shit out of me. You disrespect me, you become my freaking enemy. That's just the way it is. I'm going to go after this kid with everything I got. So the thing is that I was all excited about this because I figured, let me show my daughter, okay, that this is how I handle this scenario. It wasn't really good. It didn't really warm the relationship up, but I had to come back at this kid because he really pissed the shit out of me by calling me dude and having his shoes up on my expensive couch. So I had a little bit of an issue with this thing. So right, when he left that particular day, you know, I had some, we all have parameters. You know, parameters for your kids about time you come home, time you can go out in the morning. You know what I'm talking about. We all have this scenario when we have children, especially girls, okay? Got to be home by a certain time. You can't go out at it until it's a certain time. So the point is, it was real simple, okay? Nobody over at the house before 9 o'clock in the morning. Not a really bad situation, right? And the other thing was is that you have to come home at a reasonable time. Yeah, if you go out on a date, you know, before midnight kind of thing. You don't like it? I mean, that's just the way it is. That's the way I run my frickin' house. Before midnight, 9 o'clock in the morning, you can't come visit. So in one particular situation, this kid shows up. I mean, the doorbell rings. I got 7:30 in the frickin' morning, all right? My daughter's still sleeping. You know, my wife is getting out of bed. I come downstairs. The doorbell's ringing. It's Goofball. It's the frickin' boyfriend. He's outside. I looked at him and said, hey, and your point, what do you want? He said, I'm here to see, you know, my girlfriend. I said, really? I said, 9 o'clock's the time. He said, well, I'm a little early. I said, yeah, take a seat on the sidewalk right here. She'll be out in an hour and a half, okay? And I slammed the door in his face. I think he caught the hint that particular situation. He knew I was a little pissed off. He was over there at 7:30 in the morning. I don't do this kind of shit. Not even up yet. So the point is that he waited. He waited an hour and a half sitting on a concrete outside the door. Eventually, my daughter came downstairs about 9 o'clock. I said, hey, your boyfriend's outside. Go say hello to him. She goes, oh, he is? Oh, how nice. I said, yeah, he's kind of just got here a little while ago. I didn't tell it was an hour and a half. But I said, a little while ago. And so I said, you know, that kind of situation went by the wayside. But he caught the gist. So a little bit of time transpired. Okay, and now my, you know, this kid and my daughter, they wanted to go take a little trip to Florida. So I mean, I don't have a problem with this because they were going to go to the guy's mom who was living in Florida at the time, and they were going to stay at her house. I don't have a problem with that. It was like, you know, there's supervision kind of shit. She's going to go someplace. They're going to be once again under adult supervision. So I don't have a problem with sending my daughter, okay, on a freaking plane with this stunad, okay, and go to freaking Florida and have a good time. So my daughter comes up to me. She says, Dad, can you do me a little bit of a favor? I said, sure. What do you need, sweetie? I'll do anything for you. She goes, can you get the seats and buy the tickets and all this kind of shit? You know, he'll reimburse you for his ticket. And can you take care of the whole thing? We're going to go to Florida. These are the dates. She outlined. I said, don't worry about a thing. I'm going to take care of the whole thing. All right, let me tell you what happened, okay? So here's the thing, okay, I bought two tickets. I got them two tickets, and then like a, you know, like a great dad who doesn't really like the kid, what did I do? I got them in different seats. So I scheduled my daughter, okay, kind of like way up towards the front of the plane, and I took care of this bozo, okay, this stunad, as I said, okay, I got him all the way in the back. Now, my wife got a little bit pissed with that situation. She says, you didn't put them together. I said, well, don't worry about it. He'll sit in the back. She'll sit in the front. I mean, what if the plane goes down? She's the first one out the door. Don't worry about him. You know, he's all right. He's going to have a great time. I mean, didn't he just join the Marines? I was all excited. But you got to understand, this was the 90s. This kid joined the infantry. Not a lot of people, not a lot of kids joined the infantry in non-war. So, and that's what happened at this particular time. I knew where he was heading. I love people in the military. I think it's incredible. But this particular kid, I had a little hard on for him. So I was going to come after him with everything I had, okay? So I got them on different seats. And I said, well, if he's real smart, he'll negotiate and try to figure out how he can switch seats and get a little bit closer. It's a little bit of a challenge for him. How much does he like our daughter? You know, my wife was a little bit pissed off. I was getting off on a wrong foot with my wife on this situation. This is real early in the relationship, okay? So I have to go real easy. I got to tread water with this son of a thing, too, because this could take my hat off. So I'm having this little dilemma, you know, trying to figure out, you know, I mean, hope this is going to be okay. She's in the front of the plane. He's in the back. Yeah, I mean, obviously, I had a little bit of a problem with that scenario because, you know, I mean, my daughter came back and she said, Dad, you didn't get us. So I didn't do that because, you know why? I tried to get you. I knew you needed the aisle seat. I couldn't get the window seat. I kind of bullshit a little bit. She understood what I was trying to say, I think, you know, that I didn't like the kid. And obviously, it was shown in that particular episode. But the coup de grace was, okay, let me tell you a little situation here. So I went to the market, all right? I had to go to the market with my wife, and we had to go shopping a little bit. And so we're about 4 or 5 miles away from the house, and we're heading back to the frickin' house. And I pull into this gas station that was about 4 miles away from the house, okay? And it's in the middle of the summer. If anybody's got any knowledge about the summer in Las Vegas, it's 110 degrees. I mean, 110 maybe. On a cool day, it might be 115. On real fucking hot. Okay? Needless to say, really freaking hot. All right? So I pull into this gas station, all right? I'm going to get some gas for the car before I go back to my house. And what I see at the gas pump? It's the boyfriend. He's got a shirt off. He's got his freaking military shorts on. He's got his combat boots, and he's walking. He's walking up to the house. He's going to go see my daughter. So he looks at me, and he's at the gas pump. I'm right there. He says, oh, what a great timing situation. I was heading up to see your daughter. I'm going to go, say hello. I said, really? Oh, that's too bad. I said, I'm not going home. He said, really? I said, yeah, I'm not going home. I'm going to go to the market. And he said, wow. What a bummer. I said, well, that's what happens. I said, don't worry, big guy. I says, you know why? You're going to join the Marines. This is like boot camp. Just picture yourself in boot camp, okay? Buy some water in the convenience store over here with the gas station. 4 mile trek, take the water with you, truck all the way up. This is great training for you. This is what kind of shit they're going to put you through on a freaking daily basis in order to get you up to speed to be like a full-fledged fucking Marine. You know what I'm saying? Tough guy, always in the first one in the bush type of shit. You know what I'm saying? So this is going to train you just right. And the bottom line is when you get up there, you're going to feel totally revigorated because you walk 4 freaking miles in the blaze of heat, okay? You're ready for anything after this. And he kind of nodded. He says, you're really not going to the house? I said, no, I'm going the other way. And he goes, oh, fuck, what a bummer that is. I said, well, you're just going to have to do it. But look what's at the end of the rainbow. It's your girlfriend. I mean, isn't that worth the walk all by itself? Don't you want to? Aren't you excited? That should stimulate you, probably make you walk a little quicker. So he was kind of had his head down, he's kind of depressed about that situation. Long walk, and it's 110, 115 degrees. So he starts trucking his way up to the house. I got in the car, and my wife got a little pissed again. She looked at me, she says, I can't believe you just did that to him. I said, what are you talking about? He said, well, we're going up there. You couldn't give him a freaking ride? I said, no. I said, you know what? You know what's even going to be better? I'm going to drive right by him on the way home, and I'm going to beep the horn. And she goes, I'm going to tell you right now, if you do that, I ain't sleeping with you. Well, that kind of like, I mean, I had to go the other way. I can't play that game. I had a threat on the other side, real bad threat too. And the bottom line is, of course, you know, I'm not giving in to this particular situation. So the point is, I went the other way. I made him walk. I mean, you know, so I got my rocks off. My wife was real pissed. Took a little bit of time to get over that. We had a little bit of discussion with this situation. But the point is that I tried like a bastard to get all this crap. I wanted these two to separate. And I'm going to tell you something right now. When you do this, you know what happens. It brings them closer together. You know that. I mean, almost to the point where they're going to run away and elope type of shit. So the point is that it's a great thing to have a little bit of frustration with somebody. But understand, when you're dealing with young kids sometimes, you got to go a little easy because they can misinterpret shit just because you don't like somebody. I mean, the guy, she was ready to run away and marry the guy. The guy's a fucking idiot, all right? I didn't know how to tell her that. But, you know, at 16, 17 years old, I mean, what do you know about life? So the thing is that I tried really hard. And, you know, and what transpired? You know, she graduated high school. In 2 weeks, she dumped the kid. It took me 2 freaking years to make this kid's life as miserable as I could, okay? Why? Because he disrespected me. Day one. You don't do shit like that. And to this day, the kid never apologized. So I ain't gonna apologize either. That's what happens with Italian fathers. So the thing is I never had the chance of raising a daughter until I had this particular girl. And I raised her with all the comfort of my life. Now, I just wanted to end the whole conversation by telling you, I finally have a granddaughter in my life. Can you imagine? I'm 70 years old. I finally have a biological granddaughter. Now, I've got grandchildren. I love them. And obviously, it's from the daughter. Not with the asshole that she was dating when she was 16. He's gone. My daughter ended up marrying an incredible individual. Wonderful man. Smart as a whip. Great person. 2 wonderful grandchildren, okay? But now I have my biological grandchild, okay? She's about to turn 1 year old. Can you believe this? So just recently, you know, they're taking pictures every day. I got daily pictures on this girl. I mean, I can tell you what she looked like from day one all the way up to day 360, whatever the hell we're on. We're almost on 365 because her birthday's coming up in like 2 freaking weeks, okay? But the point is they sent me a photograph because she's in daycare. Now, this is what happens with Italian fathers, okay? Now, I'm not an Italian father. My son's the Italian father, but I'm a freaking Italian grandfather. So what that means is they sent me a photo. You know, my little granddaughter's in preschool, you know, like daycare, whatever the hell they call it. You know, she's sitting there. You know, she's having fun. She's got a beautiful smile on her face. And this little boy, kind of like 1 year old, maybe about 10 months or whatever. You know, he's over there and she's kind of mesmerized by him and she's looking at him. So right away, the thing I asked, you know, for my son and my daughter-in-law, I says, well, who's this kid? And they said, well, that's his friend. That's your friend at school. I said, yeah, and what does he do for a living besides breastfeed? You know, and they looked at me and they kind of put their hands up in the air. I said, look, I'm going to be watching him real close, okay? I'm telling you that right now, and he better respect her. So the thing is, I think they caught the hint. It was kind of like, you know, it was a little bit low key. It wasn't as crazy as when I did it with her, my daughter, my granddaughter. I'm going a little bit easy on because I'm already checking off the one-year-olds. I mean, yeah, you know, I don't need anybody taking advantage of my granddaughter. If they do, they're going to have to deal with me. It ain't easy, okay? So I thought you would like this story because it kind of tells us a little bit about everything that we've all gone through. A lot of people relate to this. I mean, you don't even need a daughter to relate to. You can have the same situation with a boy, although I don't know about that, but definitely with the girl. Because, you know, I mean, we all know what the guys are after. We know this shit, okay? So we're going to look at it real close. We're going to stare at this shit. We're going to measure everybody up. And that's the way a father should be, making sure that their child gets the very best in the world that they possibly can. So if you like the video, hit the like button, okay? And the other thing, subscribe. You get all the videos. You want to leave a comment? Leave a comment. Tell me what you think. Put it down. I don't give a shit. Tell me something, okay? Tell me a story. I like to hear stories. Bottom line is, come back. I'll give you another. Take care.
I got the horse right here, the name is Paul Revere, and here's the guy that says if the weather's clear, can do, this guy says the horse can do.